What's up, everybody? Johannes Moser here. Welcome back to yet another podcast. Today, I'm speaking with my very good friend and extraordinary composer, Bernd Richard Deutsch. Bernd was born in Austria and he now lives in Vienna, and we're not living far from each other. He has written for orchestras like the Royal Concertgebouw Orchestra in Amsterdam, the Gewandhaus Orchestra Leipzig, the Klangforum Wien, the Ensemble Modern, so really for the top orchestras. He's also been named fellow composer with the Cleveland Orchestra under Franz Welser Möst, and he has written a cello concerto for me, which was premiered pretty much exactly 1 year ago and was one of my last performances before we all went into lockdown. And it is my great pleasure to speak with him. He is one of the, I would say, most intellectual but also most interesting people that I know, and he's very warm-hearted and just really great to talk to. And the cello concerto that you wrote for me sounds a little something like this. It's a real pleasure to talk to you. We are celebrating two anniversaries. The first year anniversary is for our cello concerto, and the second anniversary is a certain thing called COVID-19.
Yeah.
And it was very interesting that they almost happened at the same time. And I wonder, what do you remember from, first of all, from the premiere of the cello concerto?
I remember that there was already a certain tension. So it was really close to the first lockdown. So we had our last performance of four on the 9th of March, March 9th. And the 10th, one day after that, they closed all concert halls in Austria. And I expected it as one of very few people. So I remember during the rehearsals to many musicians and other people about my about this feeling that it could happen, no? Because I heard that in Zurich they closed the opera house, and I said, okay, if they do that in Switzerland, it's not so far away, they will do it also in Austria. But people were still very optimistic. They said, "No, it's not that tragic." Even physicians, I remember that very well. They said, "Oh no, it's not that tragic."
Yeah,
and I think it was a shock actually. So this day after the last performance,
I remember distinctly is a sold out Musikverein.
Yeah,
and that is obviously, that was the last time I saw a concert hall that was full of people without any distancing, without any measures of precaution, without any worries, basically. I will never forget. I mean, anyway, to be at Musikverein is an amazing experience, but to have that distinct picture of it being absolutely full, it was incredible.
It was incredible, yeah. And it was a fantastic performance. So the older the four were fantastic in three different acoustics, which was very interesting to see. It's a very luxurious situation to have in such in few days to hear the same piece in three different places. They're all different.
Describe that. Describe that situation for us a little bit more in depth, because you say it's three different acoustics, three different situations, but that piece has been living in your head for 2 years or so, and then
Yes.
suddenly there's the moment
Yeah.
when it comes to life. What is that like?
It is always a very exciting moment, of course, because you are very worried about technical details. How will this work? Will it sound as I imagined it? Of course, it's even more complicated when it comes to cello concertos, because it's always difficult in the balance. Everyone knows that. And it's easy to cover the soloist with the orchestra. It's maybe easier than with other solo instruments. No? So because of the register, and you can hear that even in the repertoire, it's always a problem. So for the composer, this is very worrying all the time. So I thought a lot about orchestration, and yeah, of course, it's a fact that also the hall, the concert hall, may change the balance. So it might work in a certain acoustic, and it can get problematic in another acoustic. So that's in it's not only the orchestration. It's a factor that is not so nice for composers.
But these, of course, are, I mean, these are sort of the technicalities that you have to master as a composer. But I imagine there must be a moment where you sit in front of a white page or a white screen, and you had an email, please write a cello concerto, and then you are on your own. And from that moment to the moment of the premiere, so much happens, not only in the compositional process, but also in the process of life, in the process of maybe other pieces having to be finished at the same time, of events, political or personal events happening at the same time. And I wonder if for you these pieces are like time capsules that sort of encompass a certain thing, and when you hear them for the first time, you hear so much more than all of us, because you've been living with this music for such a long time.
Especially in the case of the cello concerto, because I started already in 2016 to work on it. Yeah, for some for few months, don't remember exactly. Maybe the first and the first half of the first movement, and then sketches from the second movement, some sketches from the third and fourth, but not very much. And then there were many interruptions, so I worked for 1 2 months also in 2017, and then there were other projects which were much more urgent. So it's a long story, and I finished it in 2019. Is that correct? Yeah, I think so. In the summer of 2019.
You are one of the few composers that actually give the music in time, which is wonderful.
That's always there's always a great pressure on composers, you know. You have to understand this.
But
It's very
some composers respect the pressure and some composers don't.
but the question is if you can really if you have control of this, you know. It's not only the will, you know. There's also a certain gravity you can't overcome. And it needs time. It needs time. And I think
Yeah.
in this case, it was actually a good, it was good that it took so much time. It's good. If you have written something, you have, of course, the form in mind. You know what you want to do. But it's good to let it rest for certain period. It's not good to do everything under pressure in just in to just to be fast. At least for me.
I
For
mean, there have
me.
always been composers that revised their works over time. I mean, if we look at the Leonore from Beethoven, or if we look at certain Bruckner symphonies, there is always even the Mendelssohn Octet. There is different versions over time, and I wonder if sort of you could avoid that process by having it. Having basically 3.5 years to complete the piece, so you already went through that sort of reworking process. On the other hand, when you hear the piece for the first time live, that of course changes a lot of things as well.
Yes and no. I mean, it's true that I'm rewriting the piece very often during the composition process. So it's of course when it comes to such situations that you let rest the piece, this is really obvious that you have a different view on what you have written after half year or 1 year, and then maybe you change something that's possible. And it's during the compositional process you change a lot. There are many revisions all the time, corrections. It's always corrections. You have to be more precise. Get as precise as possible. You have to ask frequently questions to yourself every day, and you have to resolve these questions. You have to answer these questions. And I think the piece is finished when all questions are answered to yourself. When you have this impression, you can't change anymore something, and all questions are answered, then it's finished. But when it's finished, I wouldn't change anything. You know, so there won't be ever a revision of this piece.
Yeah. Well, I'm very happy that there's not going to be a revision because I find it absolutely stunning and really like a absolutely one of my favorite concertos and then a first class just piece of music, not only concerto, but first class piece of music. It's really amazing.
Very glad
Take
to have
us Take us
that.
through that process. When you sit in front of that white page and you need a starting point, where does the starting point come from?
Often certain cells, you know, small cells, maybe a motif, maybe a chord, a harmony. In the case of the cello concerto, maybe it was the beginning, you know, which is not guaranteed. You will think, well, it's normal that it's the beginning, which is not the case, because now I'm writing a piece for four saxophones and orchestra, and I started with the second movement. And developed maybe 2 or 3 minutes, and then maybe the ending, some sketches from the middle section, and then the ending of the second movement, and then I went to the last movement, the third movement, which is now almost completeless, but there's no first movement. Just very vague ideas, but not really. I don't know. Still, I have time till summer. So I will now finish the second movement and then go to the first movement as the last one finished. In the cello concerto, it was different. I started, I think, really with the beginning. So with this G at the beginning, that opens the this solo moment with these answers, these little answers, this motif in the orchestra. And then I went on, I think more or less chronologically. So first movement, then second. Maybe the fourth movement was completed before the third. So, but more or less, it's from the beginning to the end.
I mean,
But
that is
I
also
don't.
how the piece is structured, right? I mean, it starts with that motif in the beginning of the cello concerto, which has the DNA for so much of the piece, no?
It's so the material overlaps the movements. It's not only for one movement. So it's also that there are almost no pauses between the movements. First and second, yes, it's necessary, but between thirds, second, third, and fourth movement, there's no pause. It's a bit symphonic. It's a symphonic approach, I think.
Yeah, well, I was wondering about that, about form, because this is a very, well, for lack of a better word, it's a very classical form. But obviously, you're writing very, very new stuff. I mean, the sort of a following of an opening movement by followed by like kind of a crazy scherzo to a slow movement and then to a sort of rocking finale. How appealing are these forms to you, or am I sort of misreading that idea of your form anyways?
I don't think so much on classical form. I try to develop this out of myself, and maybe it's in an unconscious way inspired by it by classical forms. But yeah, it's more a symphony. It's more like a bit like a symphony than a concerto. This from the form. If you think of classical forms, right? Because it was four movements. Which it's often the case in my concertos, but also the organ concerto, the Schenk concerto, oboe concerto. I don't know why. That's and they are all, of course, based on contrast. That's so you won't have two movements in slow tempo, for example. It's not likely. So it's more the contrast of tempo. So the first is often slow. It will not be the case here in the saxophone piece.
Well, I just looked on Spotify. Okeanos is now available to listen to. So all the listeners that are listening into and are interested in your music, the organ concerto with the Cleveland Orchestra and Franz Welser Möst is now available to listen to on Spotify. And also, of course, the piece that I love very much, Mad Dog, is available. Crazy piece. And together with your second string quartet and sort of all the pieces in Opus 30.
It's like a triptych on this CD with Mad Dog, second string quartet, and Doctor Futurity.
There is at least the myth and the saga that composers like Mozart or Richard Strauss, they were able to write out their concertos because they had it all in the head and it just sort of flew out. Let's pretend that this is true. We don't know, but let's pretend that
Not
this is
100% sure that if this is really no.
Well, I would doubt it as well, but every composer has sort of a very different method of developing a piece. And so I'm very interested to hear about your ideas starting from a cell. Have you had other experiences where you were sort of working from the outside in? So you didn't start with a small thing, but you already had sort of the outside in mind, and then worked sort of towards more into the detail.
Yeah, this case goes hand in hand. So when you have the little idea, I try to have as early as possible an inner image of the whole thing. So this is absolutely necessary. I mean, Schönberg said once then that a composer has to know already what is happening. I don't know. He said a certain amount of bars, I think. After the moment that you are actually writing, so you have to you need an idea of the whole thing all the time, and this may change, of course, because it gets an inner dynamic that you can't foresee. But the result will be always a bit different, but that's not bad. It's not bad at all. Would be it would be also boring to sit down months and just fulfill the plan. There's no surprise. I mean, it has to be a surprise.
You surprise yourself?
Yeah, sometimes, yeah, of course. And sometimes also I'm disappointed because it's not that what I originally planned. So it's possible also.
Yeah, you gave me a good good hint there with Schönberg, because we both live in Vienna. We're both not in Vienna right now, also because of the pandemic. But tell me what is so, well, what has been so influential in music with Vienna, I think, is clear with the Wiener Klassik, and then with Schönberg and all these protagonists. But what is inspiring about Vienna today, would you say?
I don't know what is inspiring about Vienna. I personally like Vienna. I mean, just for some practical reasons. It's big, but it gives you the impression to be a village. It's a big village. It's nice. The dimension is correct for me. And so the public traffic is working very well. So you get everywhere where you want. It's no problem. And yeah, it there's a lot of there are a lot of concerts and theater, so there's a lot to see and hear. So, but yeah, it's not that hectic like other places. You know what I mean? But it's good. It's ideal. It's not that big as for example Berlin. It's so big. Fascinating, but maybe a bit too big. And
Take
yeah.
us to that moment when Schönberg finally decided to leave the traditional cadence and the traditional harmony behind. Obviously, people like Wagner and Strauss and certainly Gustav Mahler had already been working on dissolving the traditional harmony. But it was really Schönberg who fired the bullet and really created something absolutely new, which actually still held a lot of traditional elements to it. But what do you think that moment was like, and what does that moment mean for you?
Well, it's an incredible moment if you think it's but you know all this whole time before the First World War, these years between 1900 and 1914 were incredible in art, in all kinds of art, literature, yeah, and music. I mean, I think from an historic point of view, what he did was logic, you know, from our point of view now. But it's easy to say that because if you have really to do it, it's really a big achievement. But historically speaking, it was logic that it happened. Because, it's a consequence out of total chromatism. And you see these tendencies also in for example, Scriabin went towards atonality. You know? Was not that extreme, of course. But well, he died also relatively young. So we don't know what would have happened with Scriabin, with 60 years old Scriabin, for example. And there were on the other side of the world, for example, was Charles Ives, and you see such a development towards atonality and atonal elements without knowing Schönberg. So it's also really zeitgeist. But of course, it was really a huge achievement. Also, if you consider how people reacted to it. He was really alone. I mean, okay, he had his circle of devoted students, of course, but outside, people thought it's just awful. He's crazy, this man. So it's I have a lot of admiration for such figures, no? Who really do what they think that is necessary to do. And incredible. I think it's a unique event. But as I said, the whole period before First World War was really very exciting, but also very dangerous. It's not a coincidence that the war broke out. So there was a lot of aggression also, which maybe in a certain way transformed into creativity, but also into destruction.
Yeah, Schönberg predicted that the birds will whistle his tunes from the roofs.
No, this, yeah, Weber. So, no,
I wasn't Schönberg.
I think it was Weber, yeah, but
Ah, okay.
it didn't work.
Yeah, I don't hear the birds yet singing either Schönberg or Webern.
Well, the birds actually are singing very atonal.
That's
If you
true.
listen carefully, it's not tonal what they are singing.
Yeah, and it's
Messiaen actually does it very well. I mean, it's very dissonant intervals when the birds are singing in his
yeah.
music.
But now, with the rough distance of about 100 years to that event of leaving Tonazzi behind, where do we stand in that development from your point of view?
I think in a very pluralistic approach, there are so many different styles. There is not the official line, you know. It's not existing anymore. I think you can practically do everything, theoretically.
But isn't that the biggest crisis of all? When everything is possible, suddenly nothing seems possible anymore.
Yeah, I don't know. Looking from far, from outside everything, you would maybe realize some similarities. But as a person who is really inside it and who does his own thing, his own, I'm writing my music. I don't think so much about this. I don't have this view because I'm too much into it. So I try to follow my demon, if you want. And that's all what you can do. Because there is no who tells you what is right and wrong, and on what basis. So you have to know it yourself.
Was exactly what you said in the beginning, like asking yourself questions, and once all those questions are answered,
Yeah.
the piece is finished.
Yes.
But who knows if there are not a million more questions. I mean, you decide what the questions are that you need to answer, correct?
It decides.
It decides. Okay.
As I always, it composes, not I compose. In a certain way, this is true.
So do you have
Can't
to
control
take
everything.
yourself away of, or do you have to take yourself out of the equation in a way?
Sometimes I have to let it happen. I mean, there's a personality, and you can't change it. There's a character, which some people say is your fate. So what can you do? But for your to answer your question, it won't be. It can't be like it was in the 19th century. So that's you can't repeat it. You can't restore it. It's finished. It's past. It's over.
When you read about events like the premiere of Salome or of well, certainly Rosenkavalier or maybe another Mahler symphony, the list of people that attended the concerts really reads like the who is who of Viennese life or of cultural life, of European life altogether. And I sometimes wonder if there is still a possibility to create that same sort of dynamic or excitement for new music at the moment. Because of course I will rush to every premiere that I read that Bernd Richard Deutsch is giving. With the event of tonality disappearing, there was also a split in music, I find. And it was maybe also the beginning of historization of the music scene. I mean, in no time prior to our time have people listened to so many old pieces. There is a big distrust from a general public when it comes to contemporary music. Why is that, and how can we rebuild that trust?
It's a difficult question because many people ask this question for a long time, I think. Now, maybe even for a century now. And there's no answer. It seems there is not really the answer. I don't know. I'm also audience. I'm a composer, but I'm also part of the audience. But as a part of the audience, I have a very different taste from most people in the audience. You know what I mean? So I would expect from this whole concert life a completely different program. But I'm very alone and lonely with my desire.
What would you expect?
Not to repeat always the same pieces, which are mostly Mozart, Beethoven, some Beethoven and then Beethoven, maybe also Beethoven. Sometimes also Brahms, but yeah, at maximum Strauss. Yeah, so it for me, I don't understand why this happens because it's very boring. We are listening. I'm here in Italy, and we are listening sometimes to the radio, at least a bit every day. And at the evening, there's always there are always concerts, recordings of concert, live concerts. Well, at the moment, it's difficult to have live concerts, but some recordings. And it's always the same program. So same program. I don't know. So even pieces, the Seventh Symphony of Beethoven, already heard in the last months here 10 times. I don't know. It's always the same. It's boring. So I would expect something, to listen to something which I don't know. Maybe I know that, of course, for people it's very interesting to hear again what they have already heard. because it's a confirmation or a confrontation of what they heard, and now they want to hear it again. I think it's also, it's also connected with this fact that it's very melodic. So most people want to hear melodies. The most easiest access to music is over melody. The harmony. So I think this tonal system was very logic. It seems to be to people very logic. And if you leave it, if you go in another direction, it has not this success.
Do you think it is that people don't necessarily have the education, let's say, of gesture, of drama, of all the things that can make up a good piece of music that does not rely on the tonal system, but still has all these elements that are actually relating to the human experience, so that they have no emotional connectors to sort of attach themselves to a piece of music that they haven't heard before?
I don't know if it's really the emotion, because if you listen to, I don't know, the orchestral pieces, Berg, no? What is Opus 6? Three pieces for orchestra, it's full of emotion. I mean, more emotion than this. What is more emotion than Wozzeck? I don't know. But the large part of the audience prefers Donizetti. Yeah, what can I do? I mean, for me, it's boring, Donizetti. Yeah. But I would prefer WhatsApp. Sorry.
It's interesting that the perception of music has sort of shifted, not necessarily what new thing am I listening to, but how is the old thing done that I already know. So in a way, it shifted from the novelty of music to the novelty of interpretation. So let's say if there is an more radical interpretation, then people will gravitate towards that. Maybe that is a
Sorry,
yeah.
sorry to interrupt you. If it
No,
comes to
go ahead.
opera,
Yeah.
it's even more obvious, no? Because the most important thing is the stage direction today. We are talking about I don't know, the Traviata by, I don't know, Carson, or some other stage director. So we are don't, it's not even Verdi in the first place. It's, and this is interesting, because it suggests something which is not true, that it would be a premiere of a new piece, because it's the version, the stage version, by this director. But the piece is always the same. Musically speaking, it's always the same. Strange, no? Very strange, from the part of the composer. It's very strange to see that, because the music you have to do really without changing any note. So every dot is important, every accent you have to real. So there, and historic informed, and I don't know what. But stage production is fantasy. I mean, it's really, it's completely against the libretto. Very often. It's interesting to see that.
Yeah, but when you look back, for example, at Richard Wagner, he himself thought that his text would be far more advanced than his music. So I think he was far more, I mean, Wagner was the biggest fan of Richard Wagner, that's for sure.
No, that's
But
for sure.
I think he was even more a fan of the librettist Richard Wagner than the composer Richard Wagner
He
somehow.
considered himself an important writer. But he was one of the few people who considered him to be a great writer. I mean, there's one interesting voice from his time, which is Schopenhauer. And Schopenhauer said, Wagner is a very great writer, author, poet. But the music is not so. He should stop setting it to music, because he's not capable of doing it. That's funny,
Was
no?
he being sarcastic, or is that actually true?
I think Schopenhauer was not a very musical person, you know, as many philosophers, you know, philosophers and music, it's not a good combination. I mean, Kant, think of Kant. They don't like music. I mean, they have no, as also many writers, who writes novels, who write novels, for example, also Goethe. I mean, Goethe and music. He was even against Schubert's versions of his texts because it was too much. It was too much music, and also Beethoven was too much, too loud, too pretentious. You know, but what is this? Which is interesting because what I like on it, Goethe hated, because music must be in the background. You know, it's an anti-music approach. It's too mental. People are too mental.
That's interesting. So you would say that if you are too much in your head, it actually works against the perception of music. Do you think the perception is more emotional that then gets transferred to the head? I mean, there is this theory that you perceive music emotionally, and then you translate it to a something that you can intellectually translate. With books, it's different because you have to read it, so you translate it intellectually into feeling. So in a way, these are maybe, it's maybe oversimplifying, but maybe these are different directions how to perceive art.
In my opinion, music is the superior art form, and for this reason, because it you can approach to it on very different levels. There is this intellectual approach, there's this technical approach. You can understand it, you can analyze it, but you can perceive it also in a completely emotional on an emotional level. And what is most important on a physical level, you know? As you see also in dance, you can dance music also, for example, which is very interesting because it's related to movements and to energy. You have to don't have this feelings when you read a novel. It's much more about imagination and so on. It's very different. But in music, it's fantastic. Music is fantastic.
Yeah,
For
you
me, it's
cannot dance the
best
Buddenbrooks.
art,
It's
best art form in the
impossible.
world. Yeah, and maybe also most complex art form in the world. Because it's so abstract, and it's maybe too abstract for some people. And also, this was what interests me is not music as background. It's not interesting, and not music as entertainment. I don't understand music as entertainment. And this is in opposition of 99% of the world, of course. Because most m people like it as entertainment. I was always often asked if I'm listening to music in my free time, whatever this is. The answer is no, not I don't like it, because I listen to music, when I'm interested to it from a professional point of view. So, because I'm interested in this piece. For certain reasons. I mean, when I compose cello concerto, of course I listen to many cello concertos, which is a very banal example. But I don't listen to it just for relaxing or to be entertained. So there are other forms which it doesn't entertain me.
Do you think that is a problem that comes with professionality and with being sort of an expert in the field?
Yeah, not expert. It is because I take it too seriously as a listener. And if it's interesting, if it's good, I'm taken by it, you know. And this is more than entertainment. Entertainment is just time passes by in a pleasant way. But it's not the case with music. It has to tell you something. It has to be enlightening and fascinating and emotional and emotional in an intellectual way. And the interesting fact is the great masterworks are masterworks because when you approach to them, always again, no? Many times, you discover new things, new aspects which you didn't have discovered in them previously. So, but in that's the same with all art, no? So the great art is so rich that it's infinite.
You're also a big movie lover and a big cinematography fan. You told me of a series of movies that you saw at the Film Museum in Vienna, and that was in a way sort of a cinematic education for you as well.
Yeah, the
Would
Film
would
Museum, when I was a student, the Film Museum was really fundamental. Theoretically, everything can be inspiring. You can't predict it. And of course, all art forms are potentially inspiring.
Because when I feel like creativity inspires creativity, yeah, there is a sort of a cycle. I mean,
For sure.
you can for sure, if you feel uninspired, it doesn't necessarily mean that you have to stick with the one thing that you need that you need the inspiration for, in quotation marks. But you can go to something else and get inspired or get creative, and that will then get your creative impetus going. I find that a lot when I maybe have a lack of creativity when learning a new piece, is that if I then go to, I don't know, photography or maybe sketching something or writing a paragraph, suddenly I feel like it also inspires my main art form. Do you have the same experiences?
Yeah, I think th there is no difference between life and art. So it does, yeah. That's maybe different to many other people. There is not a free time, yeah, which is art free or which is work free. I'm always working. The question is if I'm really working on paper. That's another question. But the mind, you are always working. Inspiration can be also nature. So everything can be inspiring. So I can't stop the motor. That's sometimes a bit annoying also.
Yeah,
And you are
it
also
is.
a bit worried all the time, when you are working on a piece, which is always I'm always working on some pieces. I had actually a pause last year. Also during this lockdown, but it was more exhaustion. For some months, I didn't work, which is a very rare event. I don't think that this happened actually before that long. But
It
yeah.
seems to me that has I've been in touch with a couple of composers, and a lot of composers have told me that during the lockdown, suddenly the creativity and inspiration, and also just the pure, in German we would say Lust, or Lust, not in the sense of a motivation, but in the sense of desire to put something on paper, just sort of went away. And I wonder if the world basically stopping to turn had something to do with sort of the general creativity on the planet.
I think so. Yeah, I felt the same way. I think that this 2020 was not really a good year. It was not a good energy. And yeah. Of course, you would think in the lockdown, you have a lot of time, you can't go out. You will be very productive, but it was not the case. I heard it also from other people that it was the same. It's not a good time. I hope it will change now. It must. So yeah, let's see.
Let's see, exactly. Bernd, thank you very, very, very much for your time. This was a very inspirational talk,
Thank
and
you.
to look into your worlds was wonderful, as always. Thank you very, very much.
Thank
Yeah,
you.
see you soon. Bye 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 bye.
Thank you.